Father, since you have awakened from death that great shepherd of your sheep, Jesus our Lord, grant us your Holy Spirit, that as we gather here in your house, we may clearly hear him speaking through his word, and in the breaking of the bread, come to know him who calls us each by name, and joyfully follow wherever he leads. Through the same Jesus Christ, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Please be seated as we celebrate the sacrament of holy baptism. Our Lord commanded baptism, saying to his disciples in the last chapter of Matthew, "All authority in heaven and on earth has been given to me. Therefore go and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit, and teaching them to obey everything I have commanded you. And surely I will be with you always to the very end of the age. The holy apostles of the Lord have written the promises for you and for your children, and baptism now saves you." We also learn from the Word of God that we are all conceived and born sinful, and so we are in need of forgiveness. We would be lost forever unless God delivered us from sin and death and everlasting condemnation. But the Father of all mercy and grace has sent his Son, Jesus Christ, who atoned for the sin of the whole world, so that whoever believes in him shall not perish, but have eternal life. Receive the sign of the Holy Cross both upon your forehead and upon your heart to mark you as one redeemed by Christ the crucified. Amen. Here also.
Hear how the Lord Jesus Christ is opening the kingdom of God to little children. Bringing little children to Jesus. People were bringing little children to Jesus to have him touch them, but the disciples rebuked them. When Jesus saw this, he was indignant, and he said to them, "Let the little children come to me, and do not hinder them, for the kingdom of God belongs to such as these. I tell you the truth, anyone who will not receive the kingdom of God like a little child will never enter it." This is the gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ. It is your task as sponsors, godparents, to confess with the whole church the faith in our God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, in whose name this child is just about to be baptized. After she has been baptized, at all times you should remember her in your prayers and put her in mind of her baptism, and as much as in you lies, give your counsel and aid, especially if, God forbid, she should lose her parents. No, thank you. That she be brought up in the true knowledge and worship of God and be taught things like the Ten Commandments and the Creed and the Lord's Prayer. And that as she grows in years, you should place in her hands the Holy Scriptures, bring her to the services of God's house, and provide for her further instruction in the Christian faith so that she can come to the sacrament of Christ's body and blood and Holy Communion. And thus, as she abides in her baptismal grace, she can grow up to lead a godly life to the praise and honor of Jesus Christ. Godparents, all these things you intend gladly and willingly to do. If so, answer by saying yes with God's help. Good. May God enable you both to will and to do this faithful and loving work, and with his grace fulfill what we as a congregation are unable to do. Amen. In order to implore the blessing of our Lord Jesus Christ upon the gathering of this beautiful little child into the family of our Father, let us, with all his family, pray the prayer that he gave us.
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen.
The Lord preserve your coming in and your going out from this time forth and even forevermore. Amen. Amen. Because this child cannot yet answer for herself, we shall all, together with her parents and godparents, faithfully speak on her behalf, testifying to the forgiveness of sin and the birth of the life of faith which God our Father bestows in and through baptism. And so I ask us all, do you renounce the devil and all his works and all his ways?
I do renounce them.
Do you believe in God, the Father Almighty?
Yes, I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth.
Do you believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son?
Yes, I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. But on the third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sits at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he will come to judge the living and the dead.
Do you believe in the Holy Spirit?
Yes, I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Christian Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting.
Who brings this child to be baptized? And how is she to be named?
Mia Stevie Zabriskie.
Okay.
This is bad.
Sorry.
Mia Stevie Zabriskie, I baptize you in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. And all God's people said,
Amen. Amen.
May God the Father, the Almighty God, the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who has now given you this new birth of water and of the Spirit, and has forgiven you all your sins, may he strengthen you with his grace to life everlasting. May it go in his peace. Peace be with you. Amen. Amen. Receive this white garment, Mia, to show that Christ has taken away and borne your sin, and he's put upon you his perfect righteousness. So shall you in faith ever stand before him. Amen. Also receive this burning light. Live always by the light of Christ and be ever watchful for his coming so that you may meet him with joy and enter with him into the marriage feast of the Lamb in his kingdom, which shall have no end. Amen. Thank you.
Let us pray. Almighty and most merciful God and Father, we thank and praise you that you graciously preserve and enlarge your family and have granted Mia Stevie Zabriskie the new birth and holy baptism, and made her a member of your Son, our Lord Jesus Christ, and an heir of your heavenly kingdom. We humbly implore you, as she has now become your child, keep her in baptismal grace, and according to your good pleasure, may she faithfully grow to lead a godly life to the praise and honor of your holy name, and finally, with all your saints, obtain the promised inheritance in heaven through Jesus Christ our Lord.
Amen. Amen.
O Lord and giver of life, look with kindness upon Timothy and Rosalind. Let them ever rejoice in the gift of Mia, whom you have given them. Help them to be teachers and examples of righteousness for all their children. Strengthen them in their own baptism so that they may share eternally with their children the salvation you have given them through Jesus Christ our Lord.
Amen. Amen. We sing a wonderful hymn of welcome. I am Jesus, little lamb.
Thank you.
God has added Mia Stevie Zabriskie to his own people to declare the wonderful deeds of our Savior, who has called us out of darkness into his marvelous light.
We welcome you into the Lord's family. We receive you as a fellow member of the body of Christ, a child of the same Heavenly Father, to work with us in his kingdom. And you, Mia Stevie, the Lord bless you in all of your ways from this time forth and even forevermore. Go in his peace. Amen. You can blow out that candle. And on this day, next year, what is required is a chocolate cake, a big one, so that she can dive into it and remember how much God loves her. I also want you to keep these things as godparents. These are reminders of those incredible promises that you made. God help you to keep them and bless you as you do so. Moms and dads, mom and dad, we have some certificates and all the important stuff that goes along with it, but my favorite thing to give away that says, welcome to God's family, which is the greatest thing I get to do. This is my favorite thing as a pastor to do, and there it is, Mia Stevie Zabriskie on April 21st, 2024, becoming a child of God. And you, my friend, be the best big sister that she could ever be. Give me five. Awesome. Thank you very much. There's the box for that. You can blow out that, you already did blow out that candle. Go in his peace. Hallelujah. Christ is risen.
He is risen indeed.
Hallelujah. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
We are gathered by God to share the love of Jesus. I'm so glad that you were witness to this wonderful thing that God did through the simple waters of holy baptism, connected to his powerful word, where this gift of God of making a child his own, bringing her from death into life, and making her a part of his family forever. Good for you that you are a part of that kingdom. Good for you that you got to see Mia be added to it as well. I'm glad that you're here, whether it's in person or out there on our live stream. It's good to be in the house of the Lord together this way, wherever we are. I'd ask a favor. Would you let us know that you're here, please? The easiest way for you to do that is to take your phone and scan the QR code that you'll find on the cards in the pew racks in front of you. That'll take you over to our worship connection card that you can fill out online. It's really helpful for us to know who God has brought into our midst. If you provide contact information for us, we'll be glad to follow up with you. And anything else that comes to your mind that we should know about your walk and your life with Christ, we'll be very glad to follow up on those types of things as well. As we are a congregation of God's people, we are rejoiced to be able to say that God continues to add to our number all the time. It's like the early church. It's a wonderful thing to see God gradually but definitely doing this, providing for us people who need to hear his word fresh. And so while it's great to see all of you folk that have been at St. Paul's throughout your entire lives, it's also really great to see those of you who are here for the very first time and those who are coming to know and be a part of this congregation. I wanted to let you know about our new member gathering that we are going to be taking part in the next couple of weeks up until the end of June. Our new member class gets people acquainted with basic Christian teachings. What is it about these Lutherans that are 10 degrees off of normal, but very good in that? But also, what is it about this congregation that sets us apart from other Christian congregations in our area? So we'd love for you to join us in that. Those classes are going to happen after worship on Sunday mornings for several weeks, with finally our rite for receiving new members into the congregation towards the end of June, on the day that we have our annual congregational meeting. That annual congregational meeting, more on that in the weeks to come. But in this week to come, I want to bring to your attention two things. First, on Thursday, we are having a blood drive here at St. Paul's. We know that we are redeemed by the blood of Christ, and his blood speaks a better word than the blood of Abel. His blood pleads before the Father for us. But your blood is a gift that you can give to other people as well. You imitate Christ if this is a part of your annual practice. So we would love for you, if you are available to help out and you are qualified to give, to join for the blood drive. There are some slots that are still open this coming Thursday afternoon, and I would love to see you here at St. Paul's and join in giving that gift of life and thanksgiving for the gift of life that God has given to you. Another thing that I want to bring to your attention, actually go back one more, just go leave it on there for the, thank you. Another thing I want to bring to your attention is happening in worship 1 week from today. That is going to be our mission festival, and I'd love for our missions ladies, could you just stand up for just a moment? We have Karen and Linda there. Just stand up. You should applaud for them because they're awesome.
Jared and Linda are part of the Mission to Serve team, as is Brenda Streed, and we rejoice that God gives us an opportunity to reach out with his love beyond our congregation. We are gathered by God to share the love of Jesus, and sometimes we do that right here in the Saratoga area. Other times it's regional, other times it's national, other times it's international. I'm still waiting for the lunar phase of that, or maybe Mars, but we'll be there sharing the love of Jesus if we have the opportunity. So next weekend, I'm actually not going to preach. We're going to have a preacher who's going to come to us, not quite live, but by Memorex, from India. Pastor Johnson Rethanasamy is the Atlantic District Missions Director, and he is currently in India, which is why he can't be with us that day. But he's going to send over a message. He's a really wonderful and powerful speaker of the gospel, and I want to encourage you to come to church that weekend to hear that. But I also want you to stay after. So after our worship next weekend, we are having a missions festival downstairs. That's where the coffee hour will be. So if you need your pastries and your caffeine, you're going to have to go downstairs. And there will be, in the fellowship hall, tables and ministries that we are affiliated with set up down there so you can learn more about it and perhaps take part in the things that they do in our area. It will be good. And so something a little bit different than what we have done, but missions festivals used to be a thing. I'd love for them to, again, be a thing in that way. So hope to see you for those things next weekend. Now let's go to the next slide. Today, on the fourth Sunday of Easter, every year, here's a little inside baseball, is Good Shepherd Sunday. And what we have in front of us is a very good shepherd. Isn't he a good boy? I don't know him, but he's a good dog. But that's not the good shepherd we're talking about. We're talking about this good shepherd. He's also a good boy, a good man, Jesus Christ our Lord, and more than good, he's also God. And Jesus says that he is the good shepherd and he lays down his life for the sheep. It's good for us to remember that on a regular basis. And so every year is not too frequent a time to say, thank you, Lord Jesus, for being our shepherd, for feeding us and tending us and nourishing us and guiding us and leading us into what we're supposed to be doing as your people. More on that in a little bit, because we as Easter people follow our good shepherd. That's our sermon for the service just a little bit later on. But we get to yet another good shepherd thought. And there you see the hands of a pastor and the word of God speaking over the words of institution over the bread and the wine, something that I've been able to do at St. Paul's for nearly 24 years. It's been a tremendous privilege since 2000 to be pastor of this church. Many of you know that there's another congregation that called me down from Hope Lutheran Church in Levittown, Pennsylvania, asking me to come and be their shepherd. After some deliberation and prayer, some wonderful counsel from you and brother pastors, and some input from that congregation, I've come to the decision to return that call and to stay at St. Paul's as your pastor for the foreseeable future. So, no. Please sit. I don't deserve that because, so you'll notice that it's not a capitalized good. I try. And I do want always to be a good shepherd to you. It's my honor to be walking in the footsteps of our good shepherd, the one who laid down his life for the sheep. And so I would love for you also to join me in being good shepherds, because that congregation that I said no to really does need a shepherd. They need a pastor. They've been vacant for a little while, and there's an awful lot of hope that needs to be spread to that Levittown community through hope. You can be shepherds to them by remembering them in your prayers and asking the Lord to provide somebody better than me, somebody who is going to be much more effective at proclaiming the gospel than I could ever imagine to be, so that the kingdom of God in that place, his flock, could grow. And the day is going to come when there's just going to be, as we'll hear in the gospel today, one flock and one shepherd. I'm looking forward to that day when I'm out of a job because Jesus, the good shepherd, has returned. But until that day, let's pray for those congregations that don't have a pastor to have a pastor. Will you join me in prayer? The Lord be with you. Let us pray together. Risen Lord, our good shepherd, you lay down your life for the sheep. We are yours.
Bless us to rejoice over how deeply you care for us and over the great honor you show us by inviting us to share your love, following you in your joyful work of seeking your flock wherever they have been scattered, until all are gathered safely into one fold under one shepherd. For you live and reign with the Father and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Jesus, our good shepherd, says that his sheep hear his voice and know him. So let's listen to his word.
The first reading appointing for today is from Acts, the fourth chapter. And as Peter and John were speaking to the people, the priests and the captain of the temple and the Sadducees came upon them, greatly annoyed because they were teaching the people and proclaiming in Jesus the resurrection from the dead. And they arrested them and put them in custody until the next day, for it was already evening. But many of those who have heard the word believed, and the number of the men came to about 5,000. On the next day, their rulers and elders and scribes gathered together in Jerusalem with Annas, the high priest, and Caiaphas, and John, and Alexander. And all were of the high priestly family. And when they had set them in the midst, they inquired, "By what power or by what name did you do this?" Then Peter, filled with the Holy Spirit, said to them, "Rulers of the people and elders, if we are being examined today concerning a good deed done to a crippled man, by what means this man has been healed? Let it be known to all of you and to all the people of Israel that by the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, whom you crucified, whom God raised from the dead, by him this man is standing before you well. This Jesus is the stone that was rejected by you, the builders, which has become the cornerstone. And there is salvation in no one else. For there is no other name under heaven given among men by which we must be saved." This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
The epistle is from 1 John, the third chapter. "By this we know love, that Jesus laid down his life for us, and we ought to lay down our lives for our brothers. But if anyone has the world's goods and sees his brother in need, yet closes his heart against him, how does God's love abide in him? Little children, let us not love in word or talk, but in deed and in truth. By this we know that we are of the truth and reassure our heart before him. For whenever our heart condemns us, God is greater than our heart, and he knows everything. Beloved, if our heart does not condemn us, we have confidence before God. And whatever we ask, we receive from him, because we keep his commandments and do what pleases him. And this is his commandment, that we believe in the name of his Son, Jesus Christ, and love one another just as he has commanded us. Whoever keeps his commandments abides in God, and God in him. And by this we know that he abides in us, by the Spirit whom he has given us." This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Brothers and sisters in Christ, as we have just heard, whoever keeps his commandments abides in God, and God in him. Yet, as we reflect on how we have kept his commandments, our hearts rightfully condemn us. But, as we have also just heard, "By this we know love, that Jesus laid down his life for us, we can have confidence in his love. We can confess our sins and receive his forgiveness so that we may know that we are of the truth and reassure our hearts before him. So let's confess.
The Lord is my shepherd. I shall not want. He makes me lie down in green pastures.
Lord Jesus, we confess that our wants often consume us. Forgive us, good shepherd.
He leads me beside still waters. He restores my soul. He leads me on paths of righteousness for his name's sake.
We confess that like sheep, we are distracted and tend to wander and scatter. We forget that we belong to you by baptism and have failed to follow you. Forgive us, good shepherd.
Even though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for you are with me. Your rod and your staff, they comfort me.
We confess that in our struggles, doubts creep in. And far too easily, we forget your promise to protect us. Forgive us, good shepherd.
You prepare a table before me in the presence of my enemy. You anoint my head with oil. My cup overflows.
We confess that we have been greedy and thankless in taking your good gifts for granted, and that in fear, we have hoarded them for ourselves. Forgive us, good shepherd. Please stand. Our good shepherd hears our cries for his mercy, and he says, I am the good shepherd. The good shepherd lays down his life for the sheep. Hear and believe and receive the forgiveness that Jesus won for you by laying down his life. In the stead and by the command of Jesus Christ, our good shepherd, and by his authority, I proclaim to you the entire forgiveness of all your sins in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen.
Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life.
And I shall dwell in the house of the Lord forever. The peace of the Lord be with you.
And also with you.
We share that peace with one another. That's peace be with you. Thank you. Hey, godparents, God's peace be with you. God's peace be with you. God's peace be with you, and with you, and with you. God's peace be with you. Thank you.
That was, that's all right.
God's peace, Lynette. Thank you. Fred, God's peace be with you. God's peace, Lori. Thank you. God's peace be with you. Thanks.
You are holy.
You are holy.
You are mighty.
You are mighty.
You are worthy.
You are worthy.
Worthy of praise.
Worthy of praise.
I will follow.
I will follow.
I will listen.
I will listen.
I will love you.
I will love you.
All of my days.
All of my days.
I will sing.
Of
mercy.
St. John in the 10th chapter.
Glory to you, O Lord.
Jesus said, I am the good shepherd. The good shepherd lays down his life for the sheep. He who is a hired hand and not a shepherd, who does not own the sheep, he sees the wolf coming and leaves the sheep and flees. And the wolf snatches them and scatters them. He flees because he's a hired hand and he cares nothing for the sheep. I am the good shepherd. I know my own. My own know me. Just as the Father knows me and I know the Father, and I lay down my life for the sheep. And I have other sheep that are not of this fold. I must bring them also, and they will listen to my voice. So there will be one flock, one shepherd. For this reason, the Father loves me, because I lay down my life that I may take it up again. No one takes it from me, but I lay it down of my own accord. I have authority to lay it down, and I have authority to take it up again. This charge I have received from my Father. This is the gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ.
The Lord is risen. Christ, hallelujah, Christ is risen.
He is risen indeed.
Hallelujah. Grace and mercy and peace to all of you from God our Father and from our Lord and Savior Jesus. Amen. Please be seated. As Easter people, just like the original disciples and those who walked in their footsteps in the early church for 20 plus centuries, we have been following the voice of our good shepherd. But I want to let you know today that our Lord has said that he wants us to follow his voice, even though his voice ascended with him into the heavenly realms on the day of ascension. That's the holiday that we're going to celebrate a couple of weeks from now. It's the end of the Easter season. For 40 days, Jesus appeared after his resurrection, sometimes behind closed and locked doors, other times out on a road to Emmaus, sometimes on a beach grilling up some fish for the disciples who had been skunked all night. But Jesus showed up one last time, and he blessed his disciples and opened their minds so that they could understand the scriptures. And as they were going along the way, Jesus began to be taken up into heaven bodily and physically before them. And he was received into the clouds, and angels came down, and they said, "Men of Galilee, why are you standing up looking into the sky? This Jesus who has gone up from you is going to come back in the same way. But right now, go into the city until you're clothed with power from on high." So where did they go? Did they go back up into the upper room and lock themselves in again? No. This time, they went into the most public of public places. They went straight into the temple, where all of the people who had previously put Jesus to death were standing there around listening to them, praising God for all that they had heard and seen. This is a beautiful thing. Our first Easter people gave us the example of what we are supposed to do. We're supposed to listen to his word and be in the house of the Lord. That's what Easter people do. We follow where Jesus is. Where do we as Christians find Jesus? Well, you can find him in an awful lot of places. First, we know that he is reigning on the throne in heaven. And so as he reigns on the throne in heaven, he says, "Present your prayers and requests to me because I'm receiving them." And he's whispering in the ear of the Father, and he is interceding for us before the Father. We can find Jesus in a very powerful and influential place. We can also find Jesus in some very humble places. Jesus reminds us that when we give a cup of cold water to our neighbor, or feed somebody that's hungry, or clothe somebody that's naked, or visit somebody in jail, that as much as we've done it to one of the least of these, my brothers and sisters, you've done it to me. We can find Jesus not only in the great and glorious places in the heavenly kingdom, we can also find him hiding himself in the lives of our neighbors. Martin Luther said, "God doesn't need your good works, but your neighbors do." So you're going to find Jesus there in that place. So we're going to follow Jesus where we can find him. We're going to lift our hearts and set our minds on things above. And we're also going to look below and say, "My brother and sister, come up here, come up higher. The Lord has a place of honor for you." But here in the house of the Lord, here in the house of the Lord, we find Jesus in two places that he has sworn by himself that he would be. We're going to find him in his word.
So when we come to the Lord's house, we come with ears wide open and hearts also wide open so that we can take what he says to us to heart. Because those first Easter people, Jesus gave a charge to preach and teach his word and to record it in Holy Scripture so that you, these latter day, present day Easter people, would have it. How awful it is, my brothers, that we have opportunities to hear and read and mark and learn and inwardly digest God's word, and we rather read and mark and learn and inwardly digest the sports pages or the horoscopes or, God forbid, Facebook. The word that Jesus speaks to us, he says, are life and their truth. They don't just teach us. They make us alive. They make us wise to salvation. They convey what he promises to us. So we follow Jesus so we can hear him. And the closer we get to his word, the better we can hear him. The problem is that this world has made us all pretty darn hard of hearing. There's a lot of noise out there. And so there's a need for us to get God's word in edgewise so we can follow. Jesus says he knows his sheep and his sheep know him. His sheep know his voice because his sheep have heard him in his word. So we follow Jesus in his word. But it's not the only place here in the house of the Lord where we can find Jesus. We can also find him right now veiled on this altar, but soon to be unveiled and revealed before you in the world. Jesus has promised that right here in this meal, located, hidden under that little piece of bread and that drink of wine, it's not just the fruits of the earth, it's the fruits of his salvation poured into a cup for you, packed into a wafer for you, that you could eat and drink. Easter people follow Jesus where he is, and where Jesus is he's eating with his disciples. Every time Jesus shows up in his resurrection appearances, he's trying to have something to eat. He has a piece of bread in the upper room. He breaks the bread out on the road to Emmaus. He's grilling some fish out on the beach there by Galilee. Jesus eats with his people. He still does, except now he says, take and eat. This is my body. Take and drink. This is my blood. It's to forgive you. It's to strengthen your faith. It's to lead you in righteousness. It's so that you can have what you need to be able to follow me. Because following Jesus doesn't just mean coming into his house. Following Jesus means going out from his house into your vocations, into the things that you do day by day, in all of the things that God has made you to do, called you to do, equipped you to do, blessed you to do. God follows you there. That's where you can find Jesus. At work in the hands and the minds and the mouth and the lives of the people that he has joined to himself, who are joined to his death and resurrection. But I want to lay before you a challenge today. You know the people that need to hear Jesus. Bear them in mind and bear them in prayer. Call upon the shepherd to reach out to them and speak to them and lead them and tend them and feed them. You know them. Be those under shepherds that lead people to the good shepherd, the great shepherd of his sheep, Jesus. But there's another challenge that I'd ask for you to consider. One of the things that we run up against in our church body and many other church bodies is a shortage of people who do what I do. Not this past fall, but the fall before. Entering into the seminary that I graduated from, Concordia Seminary in St. Louis, there were 25 people coming in. I called up the retirement program and asked them how many people were going to retire from the ministry that year, and the answer was 250. That's 10 to 1. Right now, in our church body, I've learned from our bishop, that under-shepherd, D.N. Ashley Taylor, that in our Missouri Synod right now, there are 750 congregations that are calling a pastor. Normally, they have a third of that amount that they try to keep open just to be able to move people from place to place.
But it doesn't take a rocket scientist to understand that the great shepherd of the sheep is calling out to some of you to consider being under shepherds, to consider your vocation before him, to take the talents, the skills and abilities, the gifts that he has given to you that you have honed over your lifetime, and to say, here I am, Lord, send me, send me. The great shepherd of his sheep always provides shepherds for his flock. God always provides for his church. But what we know about our great shepherd is that he works through means. When we prayed the Psalm 23 before, we said this: he leads me beside still waters. Why? To drink. He wants to slake your thirst. He led you to the waters that do the work of slaking your thirst. He sets a table before me in the presence of my enemies. Why? Because he wants to feel you to feel and be confident in your salvation in the face of all that would take it away from you. But it's the feast that God provides that sustains and nourishes you that way. How does God provide for his church? He sends pastors. He sends deaconesses. He sends teachers. He sends church musicians. He sends people who have minds and hearts and lives that are shaped by God to be able to serve God. Easter people, the first of them, followed in the ministry that Jesus laid down. John said it this way: since the good shepherd has laid down his life for the sheep, we also ought to lay down our lives for the brothers. Pray that Jesus gives you the opportunity to do that, whether it's in your vocation that you have now or the one that God has stored up for you as a gift, the blessings of which you can't even begin to count yet. It's a joy, the greatest privilege and honor, to be able to stand in the presence of God's people and stand as a pastor in his church to tell you how he feels about you. It's a privilege and the greatest of honors as his people to be able to do that for the world around us. Let this Good Shepherd Sunday be a turning point for you so that you see the world around you the way that the Good Shepherd sees the world around you, and then follow. Easter people, follow. In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. Please rise. Now may the peace of God and his call, which surpasses all of our human understanding, keep your hearts and minds ready and willing and able to follow. Amen. A beautiful hymn about this: Christ Be My Leader, 861.
in peace and confidence for ourselves and for others, let us pray to our good shepherd, earnestly seeking the green pastures and still waters to which only he can lead us, saying, Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Good shepherd, knowing that you love your sheep and the pastures you send to send and feed them, we pray for this congregation and for our pastor Adam. We also pray for our fellow deep sheep gathered at Hope Lutheran Church in Levittown, who stand in need of a shepherd and who will tend and feed them. As you are one who leads in paths of righteousness, give all pastors and congregations the ears to hear and the heart to follow wherever you lead them. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Good shepherd, in love for us and for the whole world, you laid down your life for us. Help us to hear your voice, follow where you lead, and receive what you provide through your grace and mercy. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Good shepherd, for those times we fear our enemies and the powers against us, remind us that we belong to you and no one can snatch us from your hand. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Good shepherd, we bring before you those who need restoration in both body and soul. Carry them in your arms, now and forever. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Good shepherd, in the busyness of our days, help us to take the times to reflect upon your goodness and mercy, and to have contentment and joy in the security and peace you provide. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Good shepherd, move us to remember and lovingly serve all those in need, gladly sharing all that you have entrusted to us, actively seeking to show the kind of love that you have shown us. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Good shepherd, bless us to recall the saints of old who put their trust in you, that we also may be found faithful on the day you return in glory to gather your sheep to yourself. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Good shepherd, in the holy meal we are about to receive, give us eyes to see your body and blood hidden in, with, and under the bread and wine, a table prepared, and a cup overflowing with your goodness and mercy for us. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Good shepherd, until that day you fulfill your promise that we shall dwell in the house of the Lord forever. Grant us all these things we have prayed and everything else that we should have asked, according to your good and gracious will. In your holy name we pray.
Amen.
St. John, in the epistle today, asked a really salient question. He said, if someone has the world's goods and does not share them, how can the love of Christ dwell in them? That's a good understanding of what God intends to do with the gifts that he gives to us. He gives them to us so that we can share them. His generosity inspires our generosity. And so there are different ways that we can give. The world's goods aren't just our incomes, although it is a wonderful thing to see the faithful way that this congregation supports the ministry of this congregation in that way. But there are offerings that do not fit in the plate. Our time, our talents, our testimony, these are worldly goods that the world needs. The love of Christ dwells in us so that we might be able to get the love of Christ beyond us. So God grant you the eyes to see and the ears to hear and the heart to respond to those moments where you're called to give. We need God's strength for that. Of our own accord, it's really hard. But empowered by God and the work of the Holy Spirit in our lives, we are able to do that and receive blessings in plenty so that we can and in return for all that we have given. So we want to have our Lord inspire us this way. And we call on him in song as we turn to our offertory praise. Please stand.
with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give him thanks and praise.
It is truly good, right, and salutary that we should at all times and in all places give thanks to you, Holy Lord, Almighty Father, everlasting God, through Christ our Lord, our Good Shepherd. By this we know his great love, that he laid down his life for us and has gathered us to himself as his flock. Therefore, with your whole church on earth and with all the company of heaven, we laud and magnify your glorious name, evermore praising you and singing. Jesus Christ, in the night when he was betrayed, took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and gave it to his disciples and said, "Take and eat. This is my body, which is given for you. This do in remembrance of me." In the same way, Jesus also took the cup after supper, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them, saying, "Drink of it, all of you. This cup is the New Testament in my blood, which is shed for you for the forgiveness of sins. This do as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." For as often as we eat this bread and drink this cup, we proclaim the Lord's death until he comes. Come, for all things are now ready.
Thank you.
Please stand. Let us pray together.
We give thanks to you, Jesus Christ, our good shepherd, for you have fed us with your own body and blood, which you have freely laid down in perfect love for your flock. Strengthen us by this gift, that we may live for your glory and faithfully follow where you lead. For you live and reign with the Father and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious unto you. The Lord look upon you with favor and give you peace. Amen. Amen. Our closing hymn, O Lord, we praise thee, number 617. Risen.
He is risen indeed. Hallelujah.
We are gathered by God
to share the love of Jesus.
Go in peace and serve the Lord.
Thanks be to God.